Big quick point. Questions raised about English Labour Network and policy. So two things about the English Labour Network. Certainly at this stage, we're quite clear we're not likely to be developing specific policy in most areas. We're much more likely to be saying we have actually got to come to agreement about devolution with England and sort it out and give a platform to council leaders and other people who want to do it than to say this is the line. We don't think that's where we are at the moment. It's about pushing the issues forward. And secondly, our aim is that when you look at the website or Facebook, you'll find stuff that's of use to you as an activist. So rather than sort of lengthy things sort of saying Labour should take English identity seriously, we hope over the months you'll find stuff that says, well, as an activist, what does that mean for my campaigning? How would I write my literature differently? What would my leaflets look like? How do I deal with these issues of the flag and identity? So we want to be seen by everybody as a very useful resource to go to, not just another place where loads of people like me write articles saying Labour should. Because people like me write articles saying Labour should, and we can get them published all over the place, so we don't need a new organisation. Right, next speaker. The fascinating thing about this issue is it cuts right across the different political strands of the Labour Party. I would say there are people on the right who get it and people who don't, people in the middle who get it and people who don't, people on the left who get it and people who don't. Next speaker, Councillor Santari, works for TSSA, organised Jeremy's re-election campaign last year, very much involved with the radical changes in the Labour Party, but certainly somebody who gets it. Sam.
On history of grassroots Labour activism. I want to tell you a very little brief story, which I think will kind of lead into where I'm kind of going with the English Labour Network and the things that I'd like to focus on. You know, it was over a century ago, there was actually a teenage shop worker here in Brighton who decided that the way she and her colleagues were being treated was totally unjust, that the conditions in the workplace were awful. And despite the sort of rifts of a young woman standing up in a mainly male-dominated workplace, she actually became active in what was then the shop workers union, later rising to become its assistant general secretary. And at the trade union conference in 1899, she seconded the resolution that actually then set up our Labour Party that we have today. Her name is Margaret Bondfield. She was elected as Labour MP for Northampton, and in 1929 became the first ever woman in the British cabinet on ordinary people. And their achievements, not the kings, the queens, the elites, the aristocracy, and actually not the history of empire or colonialism. You know, I'm thinking about things like the Levellers, the Chartists, the Toll Puddle Martyrs, those elements of working class history that we drew our traditions and our party on even to this day. And I think, as other speakers have said, we are living in an age where the affinity to Britain for many people is kind of ebbing away. I think that in many towns across England, people would say now that they're English rather than British. And I think, as we've seen civic sort of nationalisms in Wales and Scotland and Celtic nations on the rise, I think that that's also began to have people in England really kind of question, well, who is it that we are and what are we about and what can we do to celebrate and to be patriotic about our identity. But I think the thing that I would flag quite quickly is that it's important that we as a party go into this space and that we don't vacate it. Because if we vacate that space, it will be filled by your kind of UKIP, EDL, BNP types of organisations who want to create an identity of Englishness that is exclusive and divisive. And I think actually we can build something where the identity is inclusive, no matter what your cultural and ethnic heritage might be. And I want to talk a little bit actually about the last manifesto and why I personally think it was particularly a patriotic manifesto. I think there's two elements to this, and I think it's important because for me, the renewal of the Labour Party in working class heartlands has to be twofold. One, I think this concept of Englishness as emancipatory, historic kind of driving force that is very much in vain of our party's traditions is one part, but also the economic and social renewal of the fabric of those communities that's been left behind for too long. And I found it quite interesting when I was campaigning in the election in places like Oldham, places like Burnley, and obviously my own home seat of Dagenham and Raynham, that when you actually went and spoke to working class voters and you said to them, look, we understand that you're really angry about lots of different things. You're angry that you don't have control over your life. You're angry that your kids don't have the future that you want for them. And you're angry that every time those bills from the heating company come through your door, you're paying more and more. And that is in the context, obviously, of about 20% now of the entire British workforce basically being on the national minimum wage. So we all know, as Labour Party people, just how structurally screwed, to be honest, our economy is. And that needs to be sorted out. And when you said to those people on the doorstep, we are actually, in our manifesto, prepared to help you take back control of your life, the people responded, in my view, very positively to that. When you said, we're going to take back control, public control of the railways, of the water companies and the energy companies, things that actually people in the past, I think, felt proud of, that we're going to actually do those things in their interests, I found that we were able to actually have conversations and get a hearing, even amongst people that might be sceptical about the direction of the Labour Party and the Labour Party leadership. Because we can't pretend that there are people who don't have that degree of scepticism in some of the communities that we need to win back, whether that be in places like where Polly was the candidate in Thurrock, or whether that be places that we lost this time like Mansfield. Because all of these things are connected. Because I think we are now in a situation where if an election comes soon, or whether it doesn't, I happen to think it won't come that soon actually, we have a period when we can both reflect and to build that movement and that energy, but to do it in more creative ways. And I think we can't dodge the difficult issues. And this idea of Englishness and the concept of creating more of an English identifiable Labour Party is going to be a bit of a prickly issue. But I think it's something that we get right. If we get right, it could really pay massive dividends to us in terms of winning seats, but also in renewing that social contract with communities that feel for too long maybe Labour doesn't speak to them. And I think it will also allow us to do the maths, as it were, the electoral maths, whereby we have to win such a broad and diverse coalition of people, because it is those, you know, urban programme that is about renewing your community, rebuilding it, not just £10 an hour national minimum wage and things like that, but actually infrastructure investment that creates high paid jobs. Because the thing for me, and the rise of UKIP and even what happened with Brexit, is tied into one key fact in all of these communities, that they've had their dignity and their pride stripped away from them. And so for me, if we are able to tackle those two challenges, we could be really in quite an exciting place.